Okay, Mr. F, grade 12 essential. This is week one, the first 3 days, as we still have people joining the course. So here we go. Week one, the first 3 days of grade 12 essential. All right, so I started us on a unit called problem solving, games, analysis, and all that. So this was assignment alpha 1, A1. Right, we have different units. This is unit A. Right, there's the types of questions we have. Read those. So, for example, the sum of two numbers is 15. So the sum of two numbers is 15. The difference between them of the numbers is 3. Difference means subtract. Find the numbers, the two numbers, obviously. And then they say, so what is their product? And you're supposed to actually do the puzzle to solve this riddle and all that. It's just, you know, nice clean jokes to take home to the kids. All right, so let's try that then. I'll animate it there. There's the answer. You can pause it there if you want, or we can animate it. Here we go. What is the sum of two numbers? The sum of two sum means, anytime you see me do three bars like that, that means it's identically the same as, or it means. Anytime you see sum, it means add. Anytime you see difference, it means, in a sentence, it means subtract. Have you ever done the difference between your height and your son's height? When you find a difference, don't you subtract? What's the difference between your marks, you and your friend? Difference means subtract. And product means, well, product means to multiply. You know, go forth and multiply, you end up with a product. There you go. So there's what sum, difference, and product mean. Right now, the method we're using here to solve problems, and it works every time, is the guess and check method. You can solve every problem in the universe by guessing and checking. In fact, that's called the scientific method. You guess and you see if it's right. You guess and you see if it's right. Computers are very good at that. They do it 6 billion times a second. We're not so good. So let's do some guessing. All right, so we got to guess at number one, we got to guess at number two, we got to guess at the sum. Well, we already know what the sum has to be. And we're going to see if the difference is 3. So let's just randomly pick some numbers that add up to 15. So we want them to add to 15, so I guess number 2 would have to be 5. So you satisfy this first equation. All right, so you satisfy that first thing that says I got to add to 5. I think you know that 10 and 5 would add to 15. And then you check the difference. 10 subtract 5 is it 3? No, so that's wrong. So 10 and 5 are not the answers. So let's try it again. All right, let's try 8 and 7. Because 8 and 7 add up to 15. Yeah, so you're right there. What's 8 minus 7? 8 minus 7 is, let's see, is that equal to 3? No, got that wrong, but it's close, right? It's close. Hey, look, notice how this was too high, 5 was too high, and 1 was too low. I'll bet you that if we go halfway in between, we'll get the right answer. Let's try that. Notice I skillfully left a blank spot in there that works. 9 and 6 is 15. Yep. And let's see. I hope they subtract. I hope their difference is 3. Woohoo! I think we got her. So give yourself a little happy face there. So the numbers were this, 9 and 6. So the answer to this question, find the two numbers, was 9 and 6. And then, just so that they can see if you know your multiplication tables, they say, well, multiply them together. So 9 times 6 is 54. And if you don't have your times tables nailed down by grade 12, that would be a challenge. Math is a very big challenge. If you don't have, it only takes 2 weekends to do them. Anyway, we talked enough about that. Let's do some more here. More guessing and checking. You can pause this anytime you want, rewind it anytime you want. Find the sum of two numbers that equal 16, and their difference is 6. Find the two numbers. What is their product? All right, so we're going to do it all over. Same thing, different slide. I'll just let it animate all by itself. You just watch it from here. This time, instead of saying number 1 and number 2, I'm going to say X is number 1 and Y is number 2. It's so much easier to write X and Y than it is to put NBR1, NBR2. So mathematicians are always about making secret little quick symbols to organize their thoughts. All right, so let's try it with number 1 and number 2. And you know that number 1 added to number 2 has to equal 16. And you know that the difference, the subtraction of X subtract Y, has to be 6. So let's just guess a few. Is 10 and 6 the right numbers? No. It's 4. We want 6, so that's wrong. We want the difference to be, let's try 8. Notice I'm skillfully leaving a little blank in the middle there. 8 plus another 8 would be 16. Right? Nobody said the X and the Y can't be the same number. It's just two numbers. Nobody said they couldn't be the same. 8 minus 8 is 0. Well, that's not 6. We're trying to get 6. So that's too low. So I'm thinking, gee, halfway in between? Well, oh no, they were both too low. I'm sorry. Yeah. So it turns out this was too low and this was too low. Let's try 12. We're trying to get a 6. Well, 8 is too high. We're trying to get a 6. So I'm thinking it's halfway between the 10 and the 12. Let's try 11. 11 and 5 is 16. 11 minus 5. Hey, I think this works. 11 minus 5 is 6. Yes. All right. Give yourself a happy face. I like happy faces. There you go. Let's try the next one. So the two numbers were 11 and 5. Their product, when you multiply them together, is 11 times 5 is 55. So it's kind of nice when you write down the answer. The product is 55, and you circle it for the teacher. Teachers like it when you circle the answer, so they don't have to spend all day looking for it. And here's another one. Let's try this guess and check. Let's try it again. This one I'll just animate. This time, instead of saying number 1 and number 2, I'll say A and B. It's called algebra when you represent ideas with simple symbols and then play with the symbols. You just keep guessing until you come up with the right answer. Computers can do this very quickly. This will always work. It might take you an entire afternoon to come up with the answer, but this will always work. In fact, there are mathematical problems where this is the only way to solve the problem. And I'll just race through this one. You can always pause it. You want to make sure you know what you're counting, right? I'm going to let A be the number of wins. It's not the score you had. It's not the shoe size of your goalie. The A is going to represent the number of wins, and the B is going to represent the number of losses. So we're looking at how many games, how many wins, and how many losses there were. Obviously, there's no ties in this league. Just keep guessing. Satisfy both sentences. It has to add up to 20 games, and the wins have to be 4 more than the losses. There's your answer. Oh, this is my favorite. I love these ones. A math teacher drove past a farmyard full of chickens and pigs. The teacher noticed that there were a total of 30 heads and 100 legs. How many pigs were there? Don't you love these kind of questions? I do. And there's the answers. Let me animate all that. So I'm going to say the letter C is the number of chickens, and the letter P is the number of pigs, because that's what we're looking for. We're looking for how many pigs there were, and we also need to calculate how many chickens there were, because those are like unknown numbers. So let's just give them letters like C for the number of chickens and P for the number of pigs. Well, let's keep going here. And we're going to make sure, well, as far as I know, most animals only have one head. So I'm thinking that the C plus the P would have to equal 30. And guess what? Chickens have two legs, and cows, or pigs rather, have four legs. All right, so I would do a little calculating. It's kind of fancy math there. All right, so 20 and 10 would add up to 30 heads. Now, the number of legs, if I have 20 chickens times two legs each, and then let's see, pigs have four legs, so there'd be four times the 10 pigs would be, well, a total of 2 times 20 is 40, and 4 times, there'd be 80 heads. Oh, darn, we want 100. Darn it. All right, so we want it to add up to 100, so that's wrong. So you guess. Again, let's try, hey, maybe there's 30 chickens and no pigs. Maybe the teacher didn't notice there was no pigs. All right, so 30 plus 0, there'd be 2 30s, right? So there'd be 30 heads for sure, and there'd be 2 times 30 for the chicken legs, that's 60 legs, and there'd be 0 times 4, there'd be, so a total of 60 legs. No, that's getting too far away. Let's try it again. So let's try, so let's see, this was, we want 100, this was too low, and this was even lower, so I think we want to go higher. So let's try, I think we want more pigs, because pigs have more legs, so hey, we guessed it right. So we wanted more legs, so obviously you get more legs by having more pigs, and when I guessed 10 and 20, then it turns out that it worked out exactly to 100, right? Because 10 pigs would be 20 legs, and 10 chickens would be 20 legs, and 20 pigs would be 80 legs, and 20 and 80 would be the 100. Happy face. All right, there we go. So the answer is 20 pigs. The teacher likes it when you write down 20 pigs and circle it. And, you know, make sure you go back and make sure you're answering the question. It's amazing how many folks do a problem and they're not even answering the question. They get so excited about getting the right answer. So here's another one. How does a beaver know which tree to cut down? All right, so these are good because if you follow the instructions and fill in the blanks, it's like having an answer key. You know whether you got it right or not because your answer's there. So do the puzzle. I give you the puzzles because it's like giving you the answers, for goodness sake. Don't just hand in stuff with the numbers scribbled in and the puzzle done. That's not the aim. The aim of these is not to do the puzzle. The aim is to do the mathematics and then get a giggle out of it. Let's try this. Suzanne made a deposit of $74 to her bank. She then had $192 in the account. So after she added 74, she had 192. So how much was in the original bank account before she added the deposit? Well, let's see. This is called working backwards. So what you do is you say, well, what did she have before she added the extra money? All right. Oh, I got to go back to the right slide here. Sorry about that. All right. So let's animate that. So I like to draw pictures of stuff sometimes when I'm looking for it. Let X be the sum amount we're looking for. All right? If you're looking for something, it's got to have a name. So call it X or Wanda or whatever, but I like X. Most people use X for the unknown answer to the question. All right? So let's see. I like to draw things. I like to draw a picture. It sort of slows down my thinking there. So this says that I had some money, and then I added 74 more, and it gave me 192. All right, so why don't we just undo what was done? So let's undo the adding of the 74. So if you undo that, if you work it backwards, then before I added 74, well, I'd have to take away 74. I must have had, Let's see, before I had... Oh, yeah, so you take away 74. Because you undo the adding 74. So you end up with the amount of money you had originally, your X, is 118. And the beauty of doing this is you can tell if you got the right answer, because you take your 118 and you add the 74 to see if it does give you, in fact, the 192. Kind of sweet, eh? That's the beauty of working backwards. The beauty of working backwards is you can run it forward again to see if you were right. Neat, eh? All right, let's try this one. Next slide. You can pause and rewind these. Let's do this one here. All right, there's Aram. He gives Steve 38 of his baseball cards. Now, Aram only has 145 cards left. How many did he have before he started? Well, let's draw a picture. There's his bag with some hockey cards in it. Some cards. All right, he had some cards. And then he gave away 38, and now he only has 145. All right, so there. He had a bag of cards. He took away. I could draw 38 cards, but I didn't feel like it. All right, I thought I'd use this funny system that we invented 1,000 years ago called numbers instead of drawing 38 little cards. All right, so, So if he has 145 now, what did he have then? So, well, here's his cards. So wouldn't I give him back his 38 cards? If I gave him back his 38 cards, then we would know what he had. So if you just ask for your 38 cards back, that would tell you what you had. And it turns out he must have had 183. And you can always check your answer. 183 was his sum cards. Minus 38 is 145. Sweet. All right, next slide. Now this is the chicken and pig thing. You ready? All right, so pretend you didn't see this. This is only if you're going to join me in the math, in the applied math class. All right, so it turns out there is a way to solve it with algebra. Here, I'll just accelerate it at 8 times the speed. But it turns out we'll learn how to do this in applied math, so you don't have to guess and check. Are you ready? Here's what it'll look like. All right, if you don't like this stuff, just skip this slide. It's actually pretty easy. It's easier than guessing and checking. And it's quicker, too. And then in applied math, all you do is you plug into a computer and the computer tells you the answer. Look, there's the answer right there. 20, right? There's 20 pigs, right? There's 20 pigs and there's 10 chickens. Look, the calculator even draws you a picture and says, look here, goofball, there's the answer. So there's how we're going to do all this stuff. If you join me in applied math, we'll learn how to do all this stuff on a computer like this. Kind of fun. All right, day two. On day two, so I'm just selecting bits and pieces here. There's what we did, more guess and check. I kind of like this cyclone one. So it does help if you draw the picture. If you're just going to stare at a bunch of words and go, I don't get it, then you're not trying. I'm serious. You're not trying. So draw yourself a picture. There's a roller coaster with 16 cars on it. Some of the cars hold 2 people. Some of the cars hold 3 people. Sometimes this helps you organize your thoughts. Draw pictures. If you just sit and stare at the thing, it's not going to help. You have to doodle. You have to doodle. I think I've said this before. All right. So let's try it again here. So you got a roller coaster. It has 16 cars. Some of the cars have 2 people in them. Some of the cars have 3 people in them. And you know that there's 36 people total. So let's see. We know that the double cars and the triple cars have to add up to 16 cars. And we know that the passengers have to add up to, 36 people. So you guess that 10 double cars, 6 triple cars. So 10 double cars is going to be what? 10 double cars... So that'll be 16 cars total, 10 and 6. So if you got 10 doubles, isn't that going to be 20? And then 6 triples is 18. That'll be 38. Oh, hey, 38 people. Hey, we're getting pretty close. Now, we want to get 36, though. All right, so let's try another guess. So 10 and 6 is close, but it's not right. Let's try 9 and 7. 9 and 7 would be 16 cars, and 9 doubles would be 18 people, and 7 triples would be another 21 people. So that'll be, 39. All right, that's getting further away, isn't it? So we probably want to go the opposite direction here. Let's try 11 and 5. 11 and 5 is 16 cars. Yes. And 11 doubles would be 22 people, and 5 triples would be another 15 people, so a total of 37. We're getting close. I think we got to do one more step. Let's try 12 and 4. All right, 12 and 4. And look at that. I think this is going to work, because 12 twos is 24, and 4 threes is 12. 24 and 12 is 36. Woohoo, we got the answer. So usually it takes you 3 steps, sometimes 4 if you're really a bad guesser. Computers do this 6 billion times though in 1 second though, so there you go. All right, next slide. And we'll animate this. All right, so we're back to the undo method. All right, we just finished doing guess and check again. We're in day 2. So we already did lots of guessing. This is the undo method. Now, this is using algebra. All right, so Karen's uncle said, if you add 10 to my age, so look at this. Here's my age. I'm going to pretend it's X. If you're looking for an answer, if it says, how old is Karen's uncle, just go take the last sentence and say, the answer is X. So it says that the age plus 10, so you add 10 to the age, and then, so you got to put it in brackets, then you double that. And they say that is 90. So let's undo it. Let's undo the doubling. Well, if you undo the doubling, doesn't that mean the x plus the 10 must have been 45? Which means before you went and added that extra 10 to it, it must have been, the age must have been 35. And you check to see if that's one of the answers in the puzzle, and you'll find out it is, and then you can complete the puzzle. Make sure that you check the puzzle, because if you see this answer in the puzzle, that's a pretty good clue that you got the right answer. All right, here's Mrs. Shu making her meatballs, some nice Italian meatballs. There we go. That's called algebra. We actually did quite a bit of that in grade 11. We didn't quite see it like this, but it's the same thing. Next slide. Oh, this one's good, right? This one's a good example of working backwards. Right, let's animate it. Here, let me run it backwards here. Let me start you there. So you read the problem. There's the problem. So notice he started at some floor number, and then he went up some, and he went down some, and up and down and up. He was trying to get away. So the question is, where did he start? Because they're looking for the evidence for something, all right? So you'd have to be you'd have to know algebra to be a policeman. Ha ha. All right, so he went up, he went down. He was there, he went up, he went down, he went up, he went down, he went down, and he ended up on the 20th floor. So why don't we just undo the ups and downs? All right, so we'll just, instead of going up, we'll go down. Instead of going down, we'll go up. There we go. So you just undo what was done, and now the X is all by itself, because you undid all the ups became downs, and all the downs became ups. So you could figure out that he must have started on the 22nd floor. All right, now we're in the vehicle finance. Vehicle finance, how to buy a vehicle. And the first thing, we started this lesson, and no more than 25 seconds into it, we had horror stories from a couple students about buying cars. Oh my goodness, this is not for the light of heart. And what I'm going to teach you here isn't necessarily the gospel, because every dealer does it differently. Every year they change the laws. So this is just a notional idea of how it works. Be very careful when you buy a car. You heard the two stories that we had, right? There was two of our students right away had really kind of not nice stories about buying a car. All right, so be careful. This is not a course on tax policy. It's not a course on taxes and stuff, but it's just, you know, the basics, how to use percents and decimals to calculate buying a car. It'll be good information, but it's not going to be, they keep changing the laws all the time, all right? So we had some considerations. Do you buy new? Do you buy used? You can read all that. Watch some of the videos on my website. I give you some good YouTube videos on this. All right, there are some ideas. The advantage of buying new is you get a big selection in the lot. Usually they'll give you some financing themselves in-house, and they have a lot. You got to be careful when you're buying a new car, though, because a lot of the new cars are all electronic run. And as one of our students was saying, you know, that one little computer chip can cost you $2,000. And the other advantage of having a new car is you can actually pick your options. You can pick your stereo package. You can pick your wheels. You can, you know, pick the heated seats are kind of nice, stuff like that. Problem with buying a used car is you're never quite sure. Was it in an accident? Did somebody roll it in a ditch? You know, has it been rear-ended? Are parts fixed? Was the engine destroyed? There are websites and people that keep track of those things. You can actually type in the license number of the car, the identification number, and there are websites that try to show you whether it's been in an accident or not. And then the other disadvantage of a used car, of course, is you don't have a choice of your options. You can't say, well, I'll take it if you upgrade the stereo system. No, they're not going to do that, all right? They just want to give you the car. Does it need repairs? Usually a car needs lots of repairs starting about the third or fifth year or so, depending on the make of the car. So you'd want to check it out, right? I gave you some examples here. We discussed examples. And don't forget that cars come out when you get a 2012 car. A 2012 car, they actually sell them in August of 2011. So just because it's a 2012, it was actually made in 2011. Right? So it's usually a year older than what the age of the, what the year of the car is. And there's kind of like one like mine. Would you pay $7,000 for a 13-year-old car? I don't know. Well, you could call this guy and see what it's like. But then again, do you really want to show up at some guy's house on a Saturday night and then go for a test drive with some stranger in a car? There's been people who have had troubles with that, you know. All right, so there's some advantages and disadvantages. All right, let's look at vehicle depreciation. All right, vehicle depreciation means, well, it's the opposite of appreciation. It means things get worse. So there's how a vehicle depreciates. It goes down in value. So depreciation is how much a car's value goes down. Now, it turns out it doesn't just drop the same amount every year. The depreciation, it depreciates by a certain percentage every year. So if you have a $30,000 car, and in the first year you're going to lose 20% of that $30,000, so if you do all that fancy math, your car is going to be worth $30,000 less the $6,000, so it'll be worth $24,000 bucks. Then the next year, now your car is worth $24,000, so you take away 20% of $24,000, and you end up with $19,200. And then in year three, you do all that over again, and you end up with all these numbers. All right, you can fill in that table if you want. It just keeps going and going and going. It gets to be a bit painful. Then you could graph the dots, and you'd see that it's not a straight line. It's like, this is actually how your coffee cools, by the way. Eh? It starts out, your car loses value real quickly in the beginning. In the first couple years, it drops off really quickly. And in the last few years, you know, the car's getting to be a junker, and it doesn't really drop in value by too much in the last few years. So the slope of this line, and we discussed slope a little bit in grade 10, drops off. All right, and there's the actual values there if you want to copy them onto the notes there, if you want to see them better. All right, there they are. You can pause this if you want. So we just copied that table there. So copy that table into your notes. And you saw how painful that was doing it, right? Oh, that was painful. Now, it turns out if you do this in applied math, if you join me in applied math, oh, man, there's a lot easier way to do it. All right. Instead of keeping track of what you lose in value, just keep track of what you keep in value. If you lose 20% of value, don't you keep 80%? It's a lot easier to multiply by 0.8 than it is to subtract 0.2 of the thing you have. Yeah, think about it. Turns out in my applied math class, we'll just do it all on a computer like this, and it'll actually show you all the answers. All right, notice the curve is not linear. It's not a line. We call this exponential decay. I'm getting kind of advanced now. Okay, so here we go. Next slide. All right, let's look at your TDSR, your total debt to service ratio. Can you afford to take on another loan? It's called the TDSR. If you have more than 40% of your gross income as mandatory payments, then the banks will probably not lend you money. So here's an example here. Now the problem here, of course, is normally you do everything in the same time period, per month. Most people do budgets and figure out stuff per month. Well, if you pay property tax of $1,300 a year, how do you turn that into months? $1,300 a year is how much per month? Well, it turns out that if it's some number per month, let's see, you divide by 12. So it's going to be $108.33 a month. All right, so now you can finish off your calculations. So you got to convert everything into a monthly rate. And there's what you end up with. All right, here's another thing, too. They're bi-weekly payments, 26 bi-weekly. Bi-weekly means 2 weekly because a bicycle has 2 wheels. So every 2 weeks, right, there's 26 two-week periods in a year. So if you're paying $149 every 2 weeks for this, then that's the same as 26 times 1 divided by 12. So that'll be your anticipated car payment. Right, so it ends up being $322.83. You don't just double it because there's more than 4 weeks in most months. And then you do all the math, all your debts on the top, put it in brackets, all the debts in it, calculate the top separately from the bottom, and you end up with 39.3%. So it turns out that the bank, they might loan you the money for the car. You're pretty close to the 40%. You probably don't want to overextend yourself any more than that. Otherwise, if you owe more than 40% to like mandatory payments that you can't get out of, then you're probably going to get yourself painted into a corner. Let's try this one. Now, this question here is a little bit different. This one here, we're going to calculate what is the biggest amount you could borrow as opposed to what is your TDSR. So here we're going to say, well, we know that the TDSR can't be more than 40. So we'll plug in all that. We'll write down the formula, right? We want a 40%, and we got some amount. We're not this X. How much can you spend on the vehicle? Anytime somebody says what or how much, call it X. It's a number, you don't know what it is, so call it X. It's an unknown amount. Boom. So you plug in the formula, then you juggle all the numbers around. All right, so the 2,500 is going to go boom up to the left there. And then you're going to be left with that. Then you're going to take away the 850 and the 60. You're going to be left with, all right, this is called algebra. So you can afford $90 a month for a car. Now, I don't know if you're going to get much of a car for 90 bucks. You probably wouldn't want to waste your money, right? If you don't need a car, don't get a car. It's not a status symbol. It's not a good investment. Don't go buying a car if you don't need one. Day 3. And we did more TDSR stuff. And we were learning how to convert, we'll do more of this, but how to convert. So how do you convert bi-weekly? This is an example. Bi-weekly means every second week. So say you make $1,000 bi-weekly. Most people get paid every second week. All right, so I get paid every second Thursday, for example. So bi-weekly. So what? And you want to turn it into per month. So it turns out it's not $2,000 a month. Some people said, well, there's 4 weeks in a month, so if you get $1,000 every 2 weeks, you get $2,000 a month. That's wrong, because months don't have 4 weeks in them. They have more than 4 weeks in them. February has 4 weeks, but all the other months have like 30 or 31 days, don't they? So you can't just double your bi-weekly. So what you got to do is you got to turn it into annual or yearly by multiplying it by 26, because 26 twos would be 52 weeks. Then you've got to divide it by the 12. So there's how you convert. So if you make $1,000 every second Thursday, you're actually making $2,166 on average per month. So there's how you do that type of count. We'll do lots more of that. All right, and here's this fancy formula that we were working on. Remember I showed you in the previous day that sometimes instead of keeping track of what you lose, it's a little easier just to keep track of what you keep, because what you lose subtracted from what you have is what you keep. So it's a little easier to use this fancy formula to calculate the value of your car if you know the initial value and the amount of value that it retains or keeps. Then it's easier to do. Notice this looks a lot like the compound interest formula. Funny enough, it's compounded depreciation. And let's do some of this. So here we'll redo it again. All right, so we did some of this the other day. You could do the first line there, $24,000. So you got $24,000. You lose 10% of $24,000. So now you got $21,600 after the first year. Then you take the $21,600 and you lose another 10% of the $21,600. And that leaves you with a total of $19,440. And then you take that from the second year, the end of the second year, start the third year, $19,440 minus $19,440 times 10% of that is, oh my God, you could keep doing this, right? We want to go for 5 years. Oh, this is painful. So this is called a recursive or iterative process. You go step by step by step. Slowly you step ahead. Step by step. Turns out you end up with the answer finally. Takes a long time. Remember doing this in the compound interest formulas? Turns out there's usually a quicker way, right, with exponents. So you end up with $14,171.76. So if you have a $24,000 car and it loses 10% of its value every year, and you want to know, so what's my car worth after 5 years? We just calculated after all of this that it's $14,171.76. Watch this. All you got to do is that secret formula that I showed you. 24,000 times you keep 90%. Raise to the exponent of 5, so that's the YDX button on your calculator, and it gives you the answer straight away. Which one of those is easier? Would you rather do all of this, step by step by step, of how much you lost, or whether you rather just go like this and keep track of how much you kept? I'm thinking this calculation up here is just a wee bit easier than this calculation here. Your choice. You can do it the easy way or the hard way. I would suggest the easy way. Next slide. All right, so there's that one. Here, I'll just animate this. You can figure this out. So he gets a $52,000 car. Now, the car is still only worth $52,000. You had to pay $58,760 because the government takes a money. Every time you do a financial transaction, the government gets money. That's to pay for the governments. That's to pay for all the free stuff you get. All right, so nothing we get is free. Every time you exchange money, there's going to be tax. That's to pay for all the free stuff. So after 1 year, the car is going to be worth this. After 2 years, the car is going to be worth, It's a little easier to use the exponent function. Let's just keep using that function there. Let's keep track of how much you keep as opposed to how much you lose. The numbers are easier. And then the same thing here. This is Dave. So after 8 years, his car is worth that. And here we did a graph. We did a graph of his car depreciating. Boom, 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 boom. years on the bottom, value of the car on the top. Notice it's not a straight line. A straight line would look like this, say, boom. Right? This is called exponential decay. A straight line would be more down through there. This was not a straight line. All right, here we did it with our coffee. While we were doing this lesson, I was actually cooling my coffee. And I had a big thermometer in the coffee, and I kept track for an hour of my coffee getting colder. And, you know, we recorded the temperatures. It went from like 45 degrees down to 30 degrees, and I graphed it. And this was just my coffee cooling. Had a big thermometer in it, and you're going, well, that's not a straight line, is it? Watch. See, there's a straight line. The straight line is the blue line. Coffee doesn't cool like that. Coffee doesn't cool like a straight line. Coffee, just like your car, depreciates in temperature. All right? So it slowly starts to level off. Eventually, your coffee just gets to the temperature of the room, and it sits there. It doesn't keep getting colder. It doesn't go below zero. If it did, that would be really interesting. All right, so let's do some of these practice problems here. This is in your assignment, Bravo 2. Show your work in the work area. I gave you lots of work. If all you do is hand in these numbers filled in here, I'll go, yeah, 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 right. I'll hand it back to you. Show your work. I give you room to show your work, so show your work, please. Now, that last question was kind of interesting, eh? This last question, this is kind of advanced. If you were in my calculus class, I would show you algebra on how to do this. But you guys don't know how to do that. This is different, right? This is, I say you have a car, maybe it's a truck worth $50,000, and you've promised your son, as soon as it gets down to a value of $10,000, you'll give it to him. So your son's going, oh yeah, I'm going to get a truck when it gets down to $10,000, right? And you know that it's a Dodge Ram or something, and it loses 20% a year. So it keeps 80% each year on year of its value. So the only way you know how to do it is just to keep guessing and checking and guessing and checking. So you're just going to keep guessing at a number that you use in it as an exponent. All right. So that's what we did. We just guessed and checked and guessed and checked. And most of you got the answer pretty quickly. So I keep guessing at the end. So I try 6. Well, 6 years is not 13. How about 7? 7 years gets me to, oh, that's pretty close to 10. How about 8? Oh, no, that's way too low. So then you just keep guessing and guessing. And so I guessed at 7.2 because I knew it was partway in between. So at 7.2, it ends up being $10,028. So I'll give my son the extra $28 of value. So after 7.2 years, I'll be giving my son my Dodge Ram truck, because then it'll be worth $10,000. And we did that by guessing this number until we got close, at least close, to what we wanted. You can't always get exactly what you want. You can't always get what you want. All right? And there's another way of doing it like that. You could just keep, if you don't have an exponent button on your calculator, that'd be really sad. But you could just keep hitting multiply by 0.9, 0.9, 0.9, 0.9, and it will give you the same idea. All right. So some calculators have the exponent button like that. Some calculators have it like that. And, of course, if you join me in my applied math class, guess what? You're going to end up with something like that. The plastic brain actually calculates it and tells you the answer. It tells you that at 7.2 years, your car or your truck devalues and depreciates down to a value of 10. And it actually goes, boom, there's your answer. It does a table of you too. See those tables we did? It does the same thing. That's applied math. Actually, applied math is probably easier than this, except that you got to learn how to use all the friggin' buttons. All right, so let's do this one. So this one was easy. Yeah, 41%. You know what? The bank's probably going to say, we're not going to loan you money. So what could you do? All right? The bank's probably not going to loan you money because it's more than 40%. So what could you do? Well, what could make this worse? If you lost your job, now you're really in trouble. Or what if your rent goes up? All right? So you probably don't want to be hovering that close to 40% if you lose your job or something. What could you do to improve the TDSR, right? The total debt servicing ratio. Well, you know what? Maybe you could cut down your rent. Instead of paying $1,300 a month, go move in with mom. Maybe not. Or, you know, so there's lots of things to think about when you're thinking about how much money you have to spare to spend on luxury items like a car. Or you could go get a third job. Lots of people do. Here's Karen and Don. They got a mortgage. We'll learn how mortgages work when we do that unit on how to buy a house. So the basic idea is your total debts compared to your gross income. You don't want that to be more than 40% or 0.4. So we had to convert the gross income here. $3,400 a year is $283. $3,400 a year, well, that's their city taxes, is $283 a month. And now we're going, and we might want to, so there's their gross income there. $47,000 a year is really $39,1667 a month. And now we got this mystery number. How much extra debt can they afford? Because the debt is on the top. So you can see we got some algebra involved here. And we want to see when does it equal 4. So 0.4. And a little bit of fancy algebra. Multiply both sides by 3916. And then subtract the 108333. So they can actually... they could get a loan for $483 a month, and then they'd be kind of maxed out in the debt department. All right, so let's calculate this. That was the little squirrel there. So they're filling in the table here. This is on Bravo 2. So you don't want to be carrying 54% debt load. Imagine 54% of all your pre-tax money is going to things that are like mandatory. You've got to pay your rent. In Manitoba, you got to pay your heat. All right. If you don't heat your house, the pipes burst and then you've destroyed your house. So you don't want to be doing that. All right. Maybe this $200 was your cell phone bill. You ever tried to get out of a cell phone contract? It ain't going to work, is it? All right. And so then we say, so if you're thinking about a $250 loan, that'll put you at a TDSR, a total debt service ratio, of 54%. You don't want to be doing that. And here's one last one here. Let's animate it. We got this bi-weekly calculation we got to do. We got to turn a bi-weekly into a monthly. And there's the answer. All right, so there's the first 3 days of the course right there. The first 3 days of the course. Well, I hope that works for you. Complete.